सहनावतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै। ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्ति। वसुदेवसुतं देवं कंसचानूरमर्दनं देवकी परमानन्दं कृष्णं वन्दे जगद्गुरुम्। समस्त जन कल्याणे निरतं करुणामयं नमामि चिन्मयं देवं सद्गुरुं ब्रह्मविद्वरम्। या देवी सर्वभूतेषु शक्तिरूपेण संस्थिता नमस्तस्यै 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 नमो नमः। So, hari om and salutations to one and all. We were seeing the life of Sri Ramakrishna Paramahamsa. So, we saw he was born February 18th, 1836. And his parents, mother was very kind, compassionate, but very frank, and father was a Brahman. And how they came to settle in Kamarpukur. He had brothers, two elder brothers, and then a sister also was there, a younger sister. And how his elder brother brought him to Kolkata and wanted him to study, but he was not interested in the formal education. And in childhood itself, he had had some spiritual experiences, and the death of his father had induced a lot of vairagya in his mind. And because they are from a Brahman family, he was well versed with the rites, rituals, etc. But for him, these were not some mechanical practices. So one of the very important learnings from the life of Sri Ramakrishna is this: a ritual by itself is never mechanical. It is we who make it mechanical. The same ritual that Sri Ramakrishna Paramahamsa used to do, he used to do with so much of bhavana. So the main point of a upasana or a bhakti sadhana is the bhav, is the emotion. Where one has that shraddha that Bhagwan is real and one is worshipping that Supreme Lord. So he used to conduct pujas and rituals, etc. But he used to do with lot of bhavana. And he, at that point in time, Mathur Babu came to know about him. And Rani Rasmani had bought a land and she had built the Dakshineshwar temple. Now, it is again interesting to understand here that Rani Rasmani, so she is a widow, first point. Second point, she is from a Shudra community. So it is not that widows were always forsaken or they were not allowed to mingle in the society. That may have happened also, and that has happened, there is no doubt. But that is not what the Hindu scriptures are saying. At different points in time, different things have happened. But many times we choose to see only some aspects and focus on the negative and call Hindu culture as regressive. Now here you see the example. Rani Rasmani, she is a Shudra community and she is a widow and she has bought a land and she has built a temple also. And that group of temples, it is, one is the temple of Mother Kali in Dakshineshwar. She is the presiding deity of that whole place. And Lord Shiva is at her feet. There is the temple of 12 Shivalingas right opposite that. They are not exactly the 12 Jyotirlingas, but there are 12. Even today, if you go, you will see there are 12 Shivalingas out in front of the Kali Mandir. And then there is a Radhakanta Mandir. This whole place she had commissioned and it was inaugurated. So 1847, she took the land, and 1855, this was inaugurated. And we have stopped at that point where we saw that, you know, Mathur Babu was persuading Ramakrishna Paramahamsa to become, to take up some duty, some seva in the temple. But he was reluctant. He didn't want to do. And we find that he was more interested in the bhavana, the freedom that he had, that he could connect to the Lord anytime, in any way that he wanted, where he didn't have to follow a particular schedule and rules, etc. But one incident which happened was when the murti of Bhagavan Krishna got damaged. And the decision by the orthodox priest was that the murti must be replaced. So Rani Rasmani asked Sri Ramakrishna, and he said, if your own relative would have got damaged like that or hurt like that, what would you have done? You would have only done some, you know, remedy for him. You won't remove him. Same way, this is Bhagwan. Now, the purity with which, and please remember, it is not that he doesn't know the rites and rituals. He's from a Brahman family. He knows all this. He knows how the treatment of a murti is done and what is the sthapana done and what are the rites, rituals for it. Everything he knows. But that was precisely his point. That when a murti is there in the mandir, it is not a murti. Even today, many people don't understand that fact at all. The Hindu temples are not temples where idols are there. The idols are the manifestations of the divine, and especially in such temples where Pran Pratishtha is done. In Kali Mandir, etc., this Pran Pratishtha is done. Prana is infused into the idol. It no more remains as an idol there. The divinity is invoked there. And so it is that the murti of Bhagavan Krishna was retained, and Ramakrishna finally agreed to take up some seva in that temple. Because at that time, a nephew of his also had come, and his name was Hriday. Now, Hriday would play a very big role in his life later on. So he told Mathur Babu that if Hriday also is going to be with me to serve and to help, then I will take up some seva. So he had taken up some seva in the Kali Mandir. But after this incident about the murti being damaged, he became the priest of the Radhakant Mandir. And there he started serving. Now, where he used to do this puja. So traditionally, when puja is done, one would invoke the deity from one's heart, do the 16 offerings. That is why it is called Shodasha Upachara Puja. One offers a seat for the Lord to sit, then water to wash the hands, water to wash the feet, water to drink. Then one offers bath, then one offers abhishek, then clothes, and if some places required, then janeu, depends on which form of the Lord it is. Then chandan, kumkum, akshat, then garland of flowers, then 108 names or 1,000 names of the Lord, archana is done. Then dhupa, deepa, naivedya, mantra, pushpam, arati, pradakshina, dakshina, Rajopachar, entertaining the Lord. 16 items like this are offered. And at the end, one seeks forgiveness for any errors of omission, commission. And because Bhagavan has been sitting there for long, the belief also is that Bhagavan has got pins and needles in his feet. So one gently shakes the murti at the end. That is called Udvasanam. And Lord goes back into the heart. This is how a puja is done traditionally. The devotee invokes the Lord in one's heart into the murti or a photograph, and then one does the upachar, everything, and then again reposes back. Now, Ramakrishna used to do this very beautifully. People used to be stunned looking at him, how he would do puja, with what bhav he would do the puja. And so what happened for him, it was very real. He would come into samadhi avastha sometimes, he would come into ecstasy sometimes. And so we find here that when he is performing those rites, so when we, one of the rites is like this, where we lift our hand and we move it circle clockwise. That is called locking the 10 directions. So the bhav there is that there is a circle of fire around me and nothing evil would come to disturb me in the sadhana. Ramakrishna used to actually feel there's a circle of fire around him. That's the power of upasana, that what we really think and feel, that becomes real to us. The mind will make it real. So he would feel all this. And step by step, he would also feel as though his kundalini is rising as he is doing the puja. So many such experiences he had. And because of this reality that he gave to the entire process, people were feeling so blessed. And hence we find here that sometimes he would go into ecstasy and some processes would not be followed exactly as per they should be followed. So what his brother did, he called one priest. And he wanted that priest to fine-tune Ramakrishna Paramahamsa. So, you know, Ram Kumar, his brother, he told the priest. Now, the moment that priest used to utter some mantras, Ramakrishna's mind would go off into samadhi. So that priest told the brother, this is not possible. He is in a different state of mind altogether. And that essence is more important. Don't worry. So he went. Now, in 1856, Ram Kumar passed away. By this time, Ramakrishna Paramahamsa had seen death. He has seen his father's death. He has grown up, and also now he is around, so 1856. So he is about 20 years old now. So again, when his brother passed away, much more dispassion in his mind that life is so temporary and ephemeral. So he turned much more devotional. Now this dispassion and devotion, they go together. The more dispassion one has, the more easier it will be to tune up to the divine. And the more devotion arises in the heart, dispassion also will come. Because love of God, when one starts experiencing, the pleasures in the world are nothing in front of that love of God. The joy that one feels, the ecstasy that one has in that state. So it just vanishes. That any taste for worldly pleasure just goes away. The Gita Bhagavan says that rasavarjam rasopyasya param drishtva nivartate. The rasa for Vishayananda just goes. So he started becoming more and more devotional. And finally he was made the priest of the Kali temple itself. So earlier he was only serving in the Kali temple as, you know, bringing something, cleaning something. Then he became priest of the Radhakant Mandir. Now he is the priest of the Kali temple itself. And hence for him, the real bond with Mother Kali starts now. This is another thing to understand about his life. Whichever form he worshipped, for him that form was real. So when he's worshipping Mother Kali, Radha Kanta, Bhagavan Krishna, for him Krishna is very real. earlier we saw, no, that he was playing the role of Shiva, he actually became Shiva. Now he is worshipping Mother Kali. But now this bond that he develops with Mother Kali, that is what we call as Ishta Devata. Later on, you will see he worships Hanumanji also, and he tries other religions also. But he belongs, the main spiritual journey of his is with Mother Kali. So the form of Mother Kali is a very ferocious form. See, dark, black, her tongue is out. There's blood on the tongue. There's a weapon of destruction in her hand. She has a munda mala on her neck. She has a mala of hands on her waist. So this form of Mother Kali is a destructive form. And as I said earlier, Shiva is at the feet of Mother Kali. So where people see fear, people see, and her eyes are very big, she is in a Ugra Rupa. So where people may get scared, there Ramakrishna sees a compassionate divine mother. And he builds a bond. She is surrounded by jackals and unholy creatures, the denizens of the cremation ground. But divinity is beyond anything holy and unholy. And Ramakrishna had that connect with her. So it is that she becomes the reality for Ramakrishna Paramahamsa. Now he started worshipping her, but he wanted her vision. So the longing in his heart for the vision of Mother Kali intensified a lot. So apart from the time of puja, etc., he would sit and meditate. And he had found this place. Even today it is there, that they call Panchavati. So north of the Mandir, Kali Mandir, is this grove. It is a cremation ground also. There is a cremation ground there. So even in the daytime, people won't go there. But Ramakrishna would sit there whole night almost and meditate on the form of Mother Kali, sometimes cry in devotion to Mother Kali, seek her darshan, yearn for her, that please bless me with your divine vision. And many times when he would return early morning, his eyes would be puffed, swollen up. Because he has cried, he has done such intense sadhana. Now this went on. And one of the things he used to do while he would meditate is his janeu he will remove. See, all this he's doing by himself. There is nobody telling him what he should do, what he should not do. He is doing this by himself. Definitely, Purva Janma Samskar will be there. So he would remove the janeu and he would meditate. Now his nephew Hriday, he would say, he started thinking he has gone mad. Ramakrishna has gone mad. Why is he removing the janeu? And Ramakrishna used to say this, that don't you know that when we worship the divine, we should drop all that which limits us, including the identification with the body. Then we have the vision of the divine. This is pure Vedanta. But now he has not been taught initially, you know, in a formal way, but he is living this. So he says, this thread reminds me that I am a Brahmana. It connects me back to my body. It makes me think that I am separate, people are separate. So it is a shackle. So I remove the janeu and I meditate. And another beautiful point he said. He said, from our very birth, we have the 8 fetters of hatred, shame, lineage, pride of good conduct, fear, secretiveness, caste, and grief. He said, these are 8 fetters which bind us. And he would say that we must get free from these if we have to experience the divinity. So he would say that when calling on the mother, one has to set aside all such ideas. Now, as his longing increased for Mother Kali, even in his puja, he started dropping so many steps. And sometimes he would not do puja. He would just sit there, sing bhajans. And two people, Kamala Kanta and Ram Prasad, they are some great devotees of Mother Kali. Their bhajans he used to sing. And those bhajans used to express his longing for the mother, the devotion, the love for the mother. And so it is said he felt the pangs of a child separated from its mother. Sometimes in agony, he would rub his face against the ground and weep so bitterly that people, thinking he had lost his earthly mother, would sympathize with him in grief. And sometimes he would even doubt. See, these are phases of a seeker's life. These are things why we should understand is that otherwise we don't know how he has come to this state. We think it is some divine blessing, it just happened to him. But look at the amount of ups and downs he also goes through in sadhana. So he says sometimes in moments of skepticism, he would cry, "Art thou true, O mother? Or is it all fiction, mere poetry without reality?" He's asking, are you true or is it just fiction? If you exist, why do I not see you? Is religion a mere fantasy? And are you only a figment of man's imagination? Don't these doubts come to us also? So many people have even concluded that God is a creation of human mind. And God is a creation by the society to keep the society in control, in fear. And, you know, to make people follow a certain ideology and then to govern them, control them, and even to exploit them. So many such things are there in the mind. At a certain level of evolution, those thoughts also come. Ramakrishna also goes through these thoughts. Imagine with his purity of mind also, still these thoughts do come. Then what to talk about our mind, which has so many more impurities. But his skepticism here is not in that way. His skepticism is that I am not having your darshan. It is for that. And if you are real, then you give me darshan now. So this went on for some time. And he almost gave up food, sleep. He became so intense in his seeking for ordinary things and achievements in the world. Many times we lose our sleep and hunger and we become so intensely engaged in achieving our goal. Here is something which is the highest goal of life, not of this life, lifetimes of evolution. He had become so single-pointed, food, sleep, body consciousness, nothing, time, everything he lost. Then comes one moment in his life where he says that I felt as if my heart was being squeezed like a wet towel. I was overpowered with a great restlessness and a fear that I might not be able to realize her in this life. See that feeling? That helplessness and despair comes into the mind that I may not be able to realize Mother Kali in this life. He said, I could not bear the separation any longer and life seemed not worth living. Suddenly he saw the sickle in the hand of Mother Kali. From where he was, he jumped to pick up that sickle and he said, either you give me darshan now or this life ends here. Now, please remember, this is not some emotional drama that he is just doing superficially. His entire being longs for that darshan. And as he said, you know, he felt like his heart was being squeezed like a towel. One who has that longing only will know what is it to bear the pangs of separation. So many gopis, they experience that state. The pangs of separation. Radhaji experiences that state. Many devotees, they experience the pangs of separation. So when he experiences that, and on one hand, that is the experience, and on the other hand, he feels, I may not be able to realize. So he says, life is not worth living. And the moment he does this, and he says, I don't want to live, there it is that Mother Kali literally manifests and Ramakrishna has the darshan. Till now, he was visualizing Mother Kali and his bhavanas, etc. He was channelizing towards her. Now she is there right in front of him as a living entity. So that Murti is not a Murti anymore. That Murti is not just a bhavana that he has, that this is Mother Kali. The Murti is really Mother Kali there. That's the difference. The mother chooses to manifest as that same form. And that's what Bhagavan says in the Gita. Ye yatha mam prapadyante tam sathaiva bhajamyaham. Whichever form the devotee worships me in, I will bless the devotee with that form, in that form. And which whatever bhav, if somebody says, I want money, Bhagavan says, tathastu. Somebody says, power, wealth, position, health, anything. He says, tathastu. Ramakrishna says, I just want your darshan for the sake of your darshan. I don't want anything else. And if that is not happening, then this life is worthless. So he has the darshan of Mother Kali. And you see what happens at that time. He sees only Mother Kali. Literally, he has said, all the buildings, the temple, the boundaries, the world, everything disappeared and there was just Mother Kali and an ocean of consciousness. So his words are very beautiful. The buildings with their different parts, the temple and everything else vanished from my sight, leaving no trace whatsoever. And in their stead, I saw a limitless, infinite, effulgent ocean of consciousness. As far as the eye could see, the shining billows were madly rushing at me from all sides with a terrific noise to swallow me up. What was happening in the world, I did not know. But within me, there was a steady flow of undiluted bliss, altogether new. And I felt the divine presence of the mother. And he says, when he came out of this state, the first word he uttered was Ma. So this was a darshan that he had in the temple, Dakshineshwar Mandir. Now for her, it is not, for him, it is not just a darshan that happened once. Now for him, Mother Kali is real. Like how for Namdev, Vithal was real. He could talk, he could play, he could work with Vithal. You know, for Janabai, Vithal Bhagwan took a form and came and helped Janabai in the housework. Same way here it is. He wanted more and more. He wanted to spend more and more time with the mother and he got that opportunity. But he would see the mother, she would disappear. Again, he would see, again, she would disappear. This kept happening. In Vedant language, we say the jiva goes into Savikalpa Samadhi, again comes out, again goes, again comes out. And sometimes one then is able to see in the day-to-day interactions also. Now he wanted uninterrupted presence of the mother. So he wanted to see her both in meditation and with eyes open. And mother was playing the game of hide and seek with him. So she would manifest sometimes, he would talk, they would spend some time and she would again disappear. So she was playing with him. Because see, the bhav that he is also having is, she is the mother, I am a child. Now that is another beautiful point to understand of his life. When we have an Ishta Devata, we have to build a relationship, a bond. and channelize the emotions through that bond. And the Lord also would reciprocate through that bond. So Ramakrishna's bhav is, I am a child, she is a mother. And mother loves to play with the child. And hide and seek is something that, you know, all of us, when there's a small child, hide and seek is the simplest way by which the child gets amused. If nothing, one just takes a book and one closes, you know, one covers the face and then one immediately opens and smiles. The child is so happy with that. So the mother was playing with him, with hide and seek. And in and through this, Ramakrishna sometimes would feel, so just like a child, when the mother disappears, he would weep bitterly sometimes. Sometimes he would pass into trance. Sometimes he would be smiling, talking. Sometimes the mother would be consoling him. All this is happening. See, for him, God is very real. Now don't start imagining like what we see in the movies, that, you know, he's talking away alone and he is able to see the mother, nobody else is able to see. Don't imagine like that. Many things are happening between him and the Divine Mother where people may not even be aware that this is happening. It depends on the will of the Lord, what the Lord wants to convey sometimes. Sometimes it can be happening that people would think that he is talking by himself all alone. And that's why some people had named him also Madman of Dakshineshwar. So it many times depends. Sometimes it's a subjective experience. Sometimes it's an objective experience. Sometimes it's a combination. So there are many possibilities which are there. So now this is what he was going through. In and through this, he was continuing his duties as a priest. But sometimes he would do weird things. So once, as he was doing the worship of Mother Kali, he felt that he is not existent, there is only Mother Kali. So from this action of offering flowers to the Mother Kali, he started putting it in this way. Because he's saying, this is also Kali, everything is Mother Kali. So he's offering flowers everywhere, because she alone exists for him. Sometimes he would go and, you know, jump the milk that is there, that is to be offered to the mother. He would jump and he would hold it close to the mouth of the mother and tell her that you must drink this, you must eat this prasad, naivedya. And one day what he did, the naivedya which was supposed to be offered to the mother, he offered it to a cat. Now the people there, you know, some Orthodox people, there was a temple manager there. Now the temple manager there, when he saw this, he got very upset. He said, what is he doing? This naivedya was to be offered to the mother and he's offered it to this cat. He's really gone mad. So he complained to Mathur Babu. And Mathur Babu, he said, he called Ramakrishna. Mathur Babu knew his state, but he wants others to understand. So Mathur Babu told him, why did you give it to the cat? He said, because I saw the mother only is everywhere. In the wicked person also, the mother only is playing. In the cat also, in the inner things, there is nothing which is apart from the mother. So I gave it, because I don't see any difference. So he was living in that kind of a state where he's seeing the divine everywhere. You know, Eknath Maharaj also, he felt that. He went to Kashi to take water from Gangaji, and all the way walking is coming down to Rameshwaram to offer Abhishek to Lord Shiva. That's a yatra. That is one of the vrata that is given in our culture. That one goes to Kashi, takes the water from there, comes down to Rameshwaram, offers the Ganga Ujjal there, takes the sand from Rameshwaram, goes to Kashi, offers the Abhishek to Kashi Vishwanath with that sand. That is a Padayatra one does. So on the way when he was from Kashi coming down, in Andhra Pradesh when he came, there was a severe drought. And as he was walking by, he saw there was a donkey who was dying. There was no water. It was on the verge of death. He did not even hesitate. He just took out that Ganga Jal that he had and he fed the donkey. Everybody was like, "Arey, why did you do this?" He says, "That Shiva whom I have to worship is in everyone. Is in the donkey also. And right now I see the need here." So he fed. So these are states of devotees. See, many times we don't see all these things and then we just dismiss devotion, dismiss rituals, dismiss temples, dismiss idols, everything and say all this is humbug. Because we have not understood the bhav. Sometimes, you know, Ramakrishna would feel that what I am going through, there is nobody to guide him. Sometimes he would himself doubt whether I am sane or I am insane, because there is nobody like him there. Think about his situation. There is no formal guru yet in his life to guide him. There is no company that he can keep of a similar person like him. Even if there are other people, they all are still seekers who don't have any idea of what his state is. So he would ask the mother herself. Such beautiful points he has. He says, "I don't know what these things are. I am ignorant of the mantras, the scriptures. Teach me, O mother, how to realize thee. Who can help me? You are my only refuge and my only guide." And so he would pray to the mother that make me your instrument, teach me, guide me, initiate me. I don't know what is happening. You have to take me further. But on the whole, people have understood now that he is not acting like a mad person. He is not a mad person. They understood his purity, his innocence, his truthfulness, his integrity. And so Mathur Babu and many others, they did not interfere. Whichever way he would worship the mother, they were fine with it. Now, he wanted still more intense. Now think about it. If you and I reach even this much state, we would feel we have accomplished something in life. He wanted much more intensity. So that place where he used to go, that forest where he used to go to do his that cremation ground where he used to go to do his tapasya, he planted 5 trees there. Today that is called Panchavati. And he planted there 5 sacred trees. And there he started spending much, much more time in solitude. And there he would pray to the mother that, "Please guide me, please teach me, please make me an instrument. You know, thy will is of paramount importance. Merge my will in thy will." And slowly his visions became more intense. And now he did not see the difference. What he was seeing earlier, that the mother's vision would come and then she would disappear. That hide and seek stopped. Now for him, he no longer had to meditate to behold the Divine Mother. Even while retaining consciousness of the outer world, he would see her as tangibly as the temples, the trees, the rivers, and the men around him. So for him, she became like another person, physically as though present, that he could see at all times. He could interact, he could talk, he could, you know, connect with her. So now one thing very powerful happened. He used to keep doing this meditations. One day what happened to him was there was a terribly painful burning sensation in his whole body. This lasted for a few days. Because he would imagine that there is a certain negativity, and he would imagine that negativity in the form of a demon. This is one of the visualizations given in the scriptures, where one personifies the negativity and visualizes that the Ishta Devata has killed that negativity. So one does this strong, intense visualization, and it is a powerful technique to let go of certain negative tendencies. Anger, greed, lust, jealousy, delusion, pride, all these six impurities. So Ramakrishna Paramahamsa, he visualized this. The destruction of the sinner, the destruction of the evil tendencies, which are personified, and that becomes a sinner. So he used to intensely visualize, and that time he would feel a lot of burning sensation. So one such day, he actually saw, even without him visualizing, he felt that out of him, now please remember, this is happening in the mind. Okay? He is feeling that out of him comes a red-eyed person of black complexion, who was reeling like a drunkard. And there's another person also who emerges from him, who is a renunciate and who has a trishul. And this renunciate destroys the person who was blackish with red eyes and was drunken. This visualization, this experience was very intense in him, and all the burning sensation, everything stopped after that. What this incident was, how did this happen? This is one of the processes in sadhana. But he would also later on go on to explain that when a person becomes very advanced in the spiritual sadhana, then the mind itself becomes the guru. The purified mind itself becomes the guru, which will guide the seeker further in the journey. So he would go on to say that later. It is at this time that Ramakrishna Paramahamsa also started the upasana of Hanumanji. Now, this is something very puzzling in his life. He was already worshipping Mother Kali. He had the vision of Mother Kali. Now he is able to see Mother Kali everywhere. Why did he take up this worship of Hanumanji? Because he shifted his bhav. As a child, from a child who is relating to a divine mother, he shifted the bhav. He wanted to experience the dasya bhav. So servant and master. So he felt that I am the Hanuman and Bhagwan is Ram. So he started worshipping Bhagwan Ram and thinking of himself as Hanuman. And so he started living on just some fruits and roots. It is said here that when he meditated on Hanuman, his movements and his ways of life began to resemble those of a monkey. His eyes became restless. He lived on fruits and roots, with his cloth tied around his waist, a portion of it hanging in the form of a tail. He jumped from place to place instead of walking. This is the power of upasana. The upasak becomes one with the upasya. The person becomes so intense in the feeling that as one thinks, so one becomes. That principle starts applying. And later on, he would go on to say that he actually developed a small little tail also during that time. The power of the mind is so much, which today we understand from many of the people who have done research, the connection of the mind and the body. So when they say every thought translates as a contraction in the body, every thought also releases a certain hormone in the body. The power of the mind over the body is tremendous. That's why this is called gross body, and that is subtle mind. The subtle mind grossified is the body. In fact, the body is not this, just the external body. The body is actually the image in the mind. And that's why whatever happens to that image in the mind will also manifest on the body. So the Hanumanji's upasana he started doing, and he felt he was Hanuman and he's worshipping Bhagwan Ram. So what happened as a result? He was blessed with the vision of Mother Sita. And it is said that after a short while, he was blessed with the vision of Sita, the divine consort of Sri Ram, who entered his body and disappeared there with the words, "I bequeath to you my smile." At this point in time, Mathur Babu actually thought he has become mad. Please think about it. All these are unparalleled experiences in any devotee's life, especially no one at that time around there was even going through any of this. So society wouldn't understand him. Now even his dear and near ones, some of them like Mathur Babu, started doubting him because he's jumping like a monkey. One day it so happened that Ramakrishna was doing his duties in the temple, Mother Kali's temple. He was singing. And Rani Rasmani, Mathur Babu, all of them are also sitting there. Suddenly, Ramakrishna, as he was singing, he stopped singing. He turned and he gave one shot, one slap to Rani Rasmani. Everybody stunned there. What has happened? So, the reason for this was, Rani Rasmani, she was very clear that this is what the Divine Mother has done. It is not Ramakrishna who has done anything, because he is already in ecstasy. He is one with the Mother. Because while this bhajan was going on, and she's sitting in the Sanctum Sanctorum, her mind was occupied with a lawsuit. The moment her mind shifted from that to the lawsuit, and it continued for some time, the mother had to bring her back. So through Ramakrishna, she gave her one slap. Rani Rasmani took it in that way. So that was one incident that happened. Mathur Babu was actually shaken up by this. So he told Ramakrishna that, please, you know, you are in a different state of evolution, but we are not able to understand you. And what worship you are doing sometimes may scare people also. So we request you, please follow the rules of the scriptures and do the worship. And they said, and he said, even God follows the laws. So please help and please follow these laws. And he gave one example. He said, God never permitted, for instance, flowers of two colors to grow on the same stalk. And the next day, Ramakrishna Paramahamsa brought to Mathur Babu two hibiscus flowers growing on the same stalk, one red and one white. Meaning to say that nobody could bind him. Not that Ramakrishna is acting out of his impulsiveness or, you know, emotionalism. But this is a very different state altogether. Now people thought that maybe, you know, he has done so much of tapasya that the nerves in his body have all got heated up, and that he needs some type of a relaxation. So they send two prostitutes into his room. Ramakrishna looks at them, he just says ma ma and he goes into samadhi. So many things people tried with him, and he is dealing with all this apart from his own subjective struggle for evolution and higher states, etc. So his state, we have to understand, is not a very easy thing what he was going through. At that time in Dakshineshwar comes one in 1858, one cousin of Sri Ramakrishna comes. His name is Haldhari. Now Mathur Babu appointed him as the priest, because Ramakrishna used to spend most of the time in the Panchavati, and also even when he's doing his duties, he doesn't follow the rules. So Mathur Babu told him, Haldhari, to do the work as a priest in the temple. Ramakrishna was there. He didn't send him away. There was a room for him, and he used to stay there. And he spent his time in Panchavati doing his meditation, etc. So this Haldhari, he was very well versed in the scriptures, but he did not know the spirit of the Shastra. So he would participate in a lot of intellectual arguments and discussions and whatnot. And he disapproved of Ramakrishna Paramahamsa's unorthodox methods and his state that he used to go into. One day, Haldhari said to Ramakrishna Paramahamsa, there's a discussion going on, and he said that God is incomprehensible to the human mind, because scripture says that. Even the Upanishad will say, yato vacho nivartante aprapya manasasaha. The speech and the mind also return from there. God is not comprehensible through senses, speech, or the mind. Now, this upset Ramakrishna very much. Why? Because this Haldhari was quoting the scriptures. And you see, many times what happens is Upanishads, they are for the highest level of the student who has gone beyond all supports, forms, everything. For that person, the deepest knowledge is given in the Upanishads. Like in the Keno Upanishad, the Upanishad itself says that know that what is Brahman. So Upanishad says that which cannot be seen by the eyes, but because of which the eyes see, know that consciousness to be Brahman, not this idol that you are worshipping. So the Upanishad also tells us to transcend the form and rejects the idol and the idol worship. But that is meant for a very highly qualified student. Majority of us, we still need to purify the mind to even come to that state. But this Haldhari was quoting the Upanishads. Now Ramakrishna got very upset. He went to the mother crying. He said, oh mother, you have deceived me just because I am a fool. And all the while, I thought you are real. And now I come to know that our scriptures are saying that none of these forms and none of this is real. Just because I didn't know the scriptures and you are, I am such a simpleton, you have deceived me. And he was crying, he was inconsolable. At that time, that sannyasi who came out earlier from him, same visual, same darshan he had, that sannyasi came out from him, and the sannyasi told him that remain in bhava mukha, on the threshold of relative consciousness. Meaning, as long as we are in the relative realm, this is real. Because as long as the body is real, the world is real, form of God also is real. Only when one transcends the relative consciousness, one has completely merged the ego in the absolute state of consciousness, then world also disappears, body consciousness also goes, form of the Lord also goes, everything disappears. That is called Nirvikalpa Samadhi. Ramakrishna will have that after some time when Totapuri Maharaj comes into his life. But till then, this Savikalpa Samadhi that he used to have, and then he used to see the form of the mother everywhere. Now he was doubting that because of this Upanishad knowledge. So this is another point to understand in his life, that we should know levels very clearly. Even today, there are so many people who are interested to read the Gita, read the Upanishad, and they just take and read. And then they get all confused or they develop wrong ideas. Then they will do like what Haldhari is doing. Quote the Upanishads and say Upanishad itself is saying no need of idol worship, no need of form, no need of this, no need of that. That is the final stage of negation. And what qualification is required for it also Upanishad gives. But that we don't take that into consideration many times. And that's why it is important to study the Upanishads from a proper teacher, to understand the levels, to understand the depth properly. And Upanishad also gives many methods. The same Upanishad which for the highest student says reject the form, gives many, many upasanas for a student who is not ready. That very Keno Upanishad, which says no need to worship this form, also gives to a student who is not ready methods of using form worship. So we should not confuse this. So Ramakrishna Paramahamsa's life, luckily at that point in time, the mind which was very, very pure and sattvic, that mind came up with the answer saying, you remain here in this relative plane. This is from a relative standpoint what is being said. What the Upanishad says is from the absolute standpoint. So right now you remain here. Eventually the mind will understand. Now, of course, that happens by the grace of the Divine Mother, that such a guidance the mind is able to give. So he went through that. Now, at this time, there was his health started failing because of his indifference to the body, to the worldly life, etc. The news of his health reached the mother, his mother, in Kamarpukur. So the mother wanted him to come back to Kamarpukur, stay there for some time, you know, so that the mother would take care of him, and slowly then he can come back to his normal health. So repeatedly when his mother called him, Ramakrishna accepted and he said, okay. So he returned to Kamarpukur. And he spent some time there. Rest we will see in our next class. In today's satsang, what we did, anything to ask, share, you are welcome.
When does he get married to Sharda Devi? It is afterwards?
Now, after he goes to Kamarpukur, there he gets married. She is at that time only 5 years old.
And he is 20 plus.
Yeah. He is 20 plus. Around after 1958. So yes, he's about 22, 23. At that time he gets married. But that was like, the culture was that it was like an engagement which happens. Only after the girl attains puberty, they go to the husband's house.
Okay.
Right.
Thank you.
Om Asatoma Sadgamaya Tamasoma Jyotirgamaya Mrityorma Amritam Gamaya Om Shanti 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 Abhityom Shri Guru Pyo Namaha Haridiyam. Rupaji, you were asking something?
No, I just...
Okay. Hari Om.
Hari Om. Hari Om, Swamiji.